Penguin Random House Audio presents The Ruin of All Witches, Life and Death in the New World by Malcolm Gaskill. Read for you by Kristin Atherton.
Introduction. This is a true story about witchcraft in mid-17th century New England. At this time, none of its colonies, New Hampshire, Plymouth, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, and Connecticut, sited along America's east coast, was over 30 years old. Each was still finding its way in a new world. Unlike the icy shores of Newfoundland and Maine, or the tropics of Virginia and the Caribbean, New England resembled the old, with hills and plains, forests and rivers. For much of the year, the climate was mild, well suited to English bodies, colonists felt. Farmsteads produced cattle and corn. There were busy ports at Boston and Salem, and trade flourished. Yet life was fraught with peril. Settlers were far from home, assailed by sharp winters and sweltering summers, and hemmed in by wilderness. By day, a labourer could pretend he was still tending wheat in Kent, or herding sheep in Wiltshire. But the illusion was easily dispelled, especially after sunset. Old world folk tales, where travellers were stalked by evil, became reality, trapping colonists in nightmares of echoing isolation and heart-thumping panic. In these moments, New England, for all its hopeful beginnings, meant only the skin prickle of being watched, the twisting grip of a curse, and the terrors of the dark. The setting for this story is a remote community in Massachusetts, 100 miles west of Boston, named Springfield. There, on the border between what they saw as civility and barbarism, Springfield's pioneers labored to cultivate both land and a new way of living together. Only too aware of how closely their fragile world was overseen by God and existed at his mercy. They contended with waves of epidemics, severe flooding, and constant tension with the Native Americans they called Indians, whose possessions they appropriated. They also clashed with Dutch traders into whose territory they strayed, and with English planters further down the Connecticut River Valley. Mostly, however, they clashed with their own neighbours, competing furiously for material advantage, farmland, livestock, wealth, and power. Whenever this fury subsided, consciences were apt to be pricked, guilt bubbling up in private thoughts, and in dreams, where colonists saw their own self-serving desires wrestling with those of their enemies. But still, they didn't yield, nor did they show remorse. Instead, conflicting emotions were battered away, projected onto a diabolic other, onto witches, and thus assuaged. Springfield's disquiet settled with lethal ferocity on a labouring couple, Hugh and Mary Parsons, whose ailing marriage epitomised deeper currents of animosity in the town. He was moody, taciturn, avaricious. She depressive and delusional, perhaps suffering from paranoid schizophrenia or postpartum psychosis. Years of quarrelling, gossiping, and bitten back suspicions among neighbours, suspicions festering even between husband and wife, accumulated until a tipping point was reached in the winter of 1650-51. Springfield's community could no longer bear the presence of witches. For the Parsons family, the outcome was catastrophic. All but forgotten now, the troubled lives of Hugh and Mary, interlaced with that of Springfield's overlord, William Pynchon, were shaped by and reflect an age of upheaval and transformation. Only rarely do historians find such a fine-grained microcosm of change, a grand narrative told through the ordinary courses of daily life. For the birth of Springfield, like the colonization of America as a whole, belonged to an age of transition between medieval and modern ways of seeing the world. Magic shading into science. Tradition displaced by innovation. Communities eroded by a more strident individualism. Ancient wisdom about everything from planetary motion to human physiology was being questioned, and new technologies deployed, notably in the production of print. Even humble people learned to read and became consumers of cheap, spiritual, and sensational literature. Commonplaces about the relationship between God and man were picked apart, and new religious orthodoxies were enforced by nation states, using the law as a formidable instrument of government. Nations strove for global preeminence, searching the oceans for commodities and land. For all that, the birth pangs of this new order were both intense and protracted. Hardship, bloodshed, and persecution blighted the whole century, and change was hesitant, often subtle. Lives adhered to the rhythms of the past and the same old beliefs, with little sense of the underlying alteration of the world. Even colonists, once settled, swapped the drama of migration for routine, felling trees, pushing ploughs, making homes, feeding children. Most characters in this book were low-born migrants from England and Wales. By the 1630s, the British Isles were drifting into political crisis, due mainly to Charles I's absolutist personal rule, which, in the following decade, erupted into rebellion and civil war. Enmity between Crown and Parliament over how the nation should be governed, and by whom, divided families and communities. Conflict was fueled by economic strife. England's population had doubled in a century, causing widespread poverty, hunger, and dependence on charity. Young men struggled to set up their own households, and tenants were evicted to make estates more profitable in an era of soaring inflation. Crime and vagrancy escalated, and hungry people rioted. Hundreds went to the gallows. Communities tried to help their poor, but families who themselves were hard up did so grudgingly. Sermons from the pulpit and ballads sung in alehouses lamented the passing of happier times. Religion, too, was a source of bitter conflict. During the long ordeal of Europe's Protestant Reformation and Counter-Reformations, every point of doctrine was debated, and no longer just by academic churchmen, but by ordinary people, for whom finding the true road to salvation was a matter of eternal life or death. Sacred devotions, furthermore, had become a touchstone for secular allegiance. To a suspicious political establishment, free thinking meant sedition. Dissent was construed as treason. Passions raged as reformers smashed idolatrous art, and Catholic and Protestants alike burned heretical books. In Britain, Charles I was detested not just as a tyrant, but also for restoring ornamentation to parish churches, whose interiors, like the liturgy, had been simplified in the first wave of the Reformation. Protestant idealists, derided by their enemies as Puritans, who already craved a further cleansing of religion, were horrified by what they saw as Catholic backsliding, and set their faces against Charles's regime. Conversely, the Crown censured Puritan ministers for neglecting official ceremonies, which these ministers saw as superstitious, idolatrous even, and for preaching that the one true law was the word of God, Christ, the one perfect monarch. For the duration of earthly life, though, the authority of kings and bishops prevailed. Puritans were jailed or put to death. But there was one alternative left to them: to flee to the tolerant haven of New England, there to build a new life, ordered by their faith.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.